The Department of Hematology, CMC Hello. Ma'am is Associate Professor in the Department of Hematology. Her primary areas of interest is in Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and also in cost-effective modification of therapy in hematological malignancies. So today we have a topic, approach to lymphomas, on which ma'am will be covering on a basic diagnostic evaluation and management for the same. This is meant for medicine PGs, but anyone who's interested, please feel free to log in. Any doubts, please feel free to ask ma'am directly, or can admit yourself, or can put down your questions in the chat box. This lecture will soon be uploaded on Department of Medicine YouTube website. Ma'am is someone who's very approachable, and any doubts, please feel free to ask, or maybe you can mail in later also. Thanks again, ma'am, for agreeing to take this lecture for us. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. For the next hour or so, I'll be talking about how we approach the treatment of lymphomas, the evaluation and treatment of lymphomas, with not so much of a focus on the diagnosis, because that would go beyond the scope of what I can attempt to do in the next hour. So the WHO has been classifying lymphomas over the last 20 years, and every 6-7 years or so, they come out with a revision of their classification. So the last one was revised about 5 years ago in 2016, and it was officially published in 2017. And I'm putting this up just to illustrate the scope of variety and heterogeneity that's there in lymphomas. It's not a single disease, and how we approach these lymphomas or the specific lymphoma we want to depends on where it falls within the classification. So I'm just putting up the list here. It may not be, in fact, the font is too small to even read out, but just to know that this is the entire list of B-cell lymphomas, and then the T-cell lymphomas, and of course the Hodgkin lymphomas. So as well as the rarer post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorders at the bottom here. So this is, and they have classified it very minutely based on clinical presentation, the histopathology, the genetic features, and how one approaches treatment. So conceptually, it's easier to remember how to classify these lymphomas if we look at the genesis of a B. This is for the B cell, and then I'll talk a little bit about the T cell later. The B cells initially are formed within the bone marrow, and any... this mouse isn't real. Any mutations which occur which result in a neoplasm at this point would result in a leukemia. So that would be the B lymphoblastic leukemias and lymphomas. Once the B cells leave the bone marrow and enter the peripheral blood, they are still unexposed to antigen. So these are the naive B cells, and these may be seen in the peripheral blood or in the mantle zone of the lymph node. And this pre-germinal center lymphomas are essentially the mantle cell lymphomas. The bulk of the lymphomas actually form from the germinal center, and these would include the follicular lymphomas, diffuse large B-cell lymphomas, Burkitt's lymphoma, Hodgkin lymphoma. All of them would arise from B-cells where mutations arise when the cell is within the germinal center part of the transformation of the B-cell. A post-germinal center, we know that it goes on to become a memory B-cell and a plasma cell. So these are the post-germinal center lymphomas, and also where the myeloma cells arise from. The lymphomas are the lymphoplasmacytic lymphomas and the marginal zone lymphomas. CLL can also occur either within the germinal center or in the post-germinal center zones. So this is how the really lymphomas are classified based on where they arise within the maturation of a B cell. For a T cell, it's not as clear, but it's more or less the same in the marrow, and then the thymus. Both of these would result in T cell lymphoma leukemias. And when the T cells enter the peripheral blood, either as gamma delta T cells, a subset, the NK cells, or the CD4 and CD8 positive cells, they would form T cell lymphomas either in the peripheral blood or in the node, or in here they differ from B cells in being they have a lot of extranodal sites where T cell lymphomas can present. In general, when you look at the entire spectrum of lymphomas, it's good to know that between the non-Hodgkin and Hodgkin lymphomas, every subtype requires treatment except for the indolent non-Hodgkin lymphomas. So these can vary. They can be T-cell, they could be B-cell, they could be, there are various subtypes of indolent lymphomas. And I'll be dealing with, just giving a few examples of these. But they're indolent and patients survive for years, whether they're treated or they're not treated. By and large, there are a few of them that can progress fairly rapidly, but by and large, patients will survive for years. Generally, these are not curable, and therefore, one needs to have very specific indications before we treat, because sometimes the toxicity of the treatment, it's in counter with the actual survival of these patients had they not been treated. So as far as possible, to defer treatment if asymptomatic. Whereas the aggressive non-Hodgkin lymphomas, very aggressive subtypes, and all types of Hodgkins are curable in many cases, and anyway, they definitely need treatment because in the absence of treatment, the survival is extremely short, ranging from weeks to months, depending on the subtype. So coming to B-cell lymphomas, the first question, this is the entire list I put up again of the B-cell lymphomas, in which I will deal with two of them, the diffuse large B-cell lymphoma and follicular lymphoma. I'll very briefly talk about CLL also. So these are exemplifying the two high. One is a high-grade lymphoma and one is a low-grade lymphoma. And the approach to these two is very different. So the first question to ask when you have a B-cell lymphoma is it a high-grade or a low-grade? Because now going through this entire list, there are many, many of these that are low-grade lymphomas that might not need treatment at first, at the time of first diagnosis. So if it is low-grade, is treatment indicated at all at that time point? If not, how do we follow up the patient regularly to ensure that there's a timely treatment and we don't miss a window before which they actually progress very rapidly? So after the initial diagnosis and understanding whether it's a high-grade or low-grade lymphoma, then all patients would have to be staged. All patients, depending on the subtype, there are very, very different risk stratifications which will determine the prognosis of these patients. And we'll talk about DLBCL and follicular lymphoma in brief. Then the part about therapy, there's a backbone to all chemotherapeutic regimens in B-cell lymphomas, and it is almost always based on the regimen of R-CHOP. But beyond that, I'll go into the drugs a little bit later, but beyond that, the first question to be asked at the time of diagnosis, aside from the stage and the risk stratification, is whether based on the lymphoma, what the lymphoma is, whether you need standard therapy that is just R-CHOP, whether you would want to intensify in any way, there are intensifications which one can do to this backbone regimen, or whether the patient needs consolidation either with radiotherapy or with stem cell transplant in certain cases. On the other hand, if a patient is not fit, if they have a poor ECOG, the elderly, they have other comorbidities, then at diagnosis, it's important to know whether to dose reduce this backbone therapy to avoid treatment-related mortality. So when you come to diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, really, I'd say about of the high-grade lymphomas, 80% of them would be DLBCLs. The concept of DLBCL has changed a lot over the last few years, and I'm not going into the histopathology or the diagnosis of DLBCL, but just some of the ways in which our understanding of DLBCL has changed and how we approach treatment in these very common high-grade lymphomas. So we'll do a little bit about risk stratification, what is the role of PET scan in imaging, how we treat, and what are the specific subgroups which have a very poor prognosis within diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. So over the last, especially in the last 5 years, WHO has changed the spectrum of DLBCL from being just a single entity to having subtypes within it. Now, these subtypes are determined either by gene expression profiling or by immunohistochemistry or by FISH or fluorescence in situ hybridization technology that will tell us what are the different subtypes within DLBCL. As we move towards the left, these are the more aggressive neoplasms, even more than DLBCL. This is a DLBCL borderline with Burkitt lymphoma. Then you have the Burkitt lymphoma, and then you have the blastoid neoplasms, of which the lymphoblastic lymphoma leukemia exemplifies the blastoid NHLs. So you can see that there is a spectrum here, and where you fall on the spectrum really depends on the histology, as well as the immunohistochemistry, which is routinely performed on all biopsies. So coming to the cell of origin, and a little bit about double-hit lymphomas. What are these? So we know that the diffuse large B-cell lymphoma arises predominantly within the germinal center. There is a subgroup of, I won't go into the mutations that they acquire within the germinal center here, because in DLBCL, there is no one specific mutation which will render it a DLBCL. It's not that if you have this genetic change, it's a DLBCL. It's more about morphology. And when you come to genetic changes, it's a pattern of genetic change that you see that's beyond the scope of most clinical laboratories to do that. It's more in, you know, it's more in trials that they would do gene expression profiling. So all DLBCLs would arise within the germinal center, and some of them arise from cells which have just exited the germinal center or the activated B cell. Now, these are the two subtypes of DLBCL which have been described by the WHO, the germinal center B cell and the activated B cell. These two subtypes are differentiated based on gene expression profiling. You can see that the outcomes in the GCB subtype is far superior to the ABC subtype of DLBCL. We don't have access to gene expression profiling, but immunohistochemistry can help to delineate these two groups. And that's done by various algorithms. The most common, I've put these up not for the detail of the immunohistochemical markers, but just to know that there are several different algorithms that can be used. The most commonly used is the Hans algorithm, which will define a germinal center type versus a non-germinal center type DLBCL. Where gene expression, this is a picture showing gene expression profiling, and you can see that there are multiple genetic markers that are done, which gives a genetic signature, dividing the DLBCL into the ABC subtype. You can see that the expression profiling is far different from the GCB subtype. And the primary mediastinal large B-cell lymphoma, which is a subtype specific to the mediastinum and has a slightly different treatment algorithm that has got a different gene expression profiling from GCB subtype. So here, just to know that there's an ABC and a GCB. And when we look at our biopsies, it's important to look at the biopsy. The pathologist will always say whether this is a GCB subtype DLBCL or a non-GCB subtype. It has a prognostic impact. It does not at present have a therapeutic impact. We don't change therapy because it's been shown that so far that intensification of therapy doesn't really help in improving the outcome of the non-GCB subtype. So here I've written WHO 2017 because that's when the official publication came out. One could refer to it as the 2016 WHO, because all the changes came out the previous year. So therefore, the changes in nomenclature and treatment based on the molecular subtypes in DLBCL, the most important of which for us is the cell of origin or the GCB versus non-GCB that we just talked about. The other that has a much more of a worse prognosis is subtypes of DLBCL that are defined on the FISH or on other genetic, cytogenetic markers. And these define specific subgroups which are known as the double hit or triple hit lymphomas, the double expressor lymphomas, and high grade B-cell lymphomas with blastoid morphology. Now, all of these have a disease course that is worse than that which we see in a standard DLBCL. Of these, the one which is important to us is the double expressor DLBCL, because this is done, when we say double expressor, they do that, the markers on immunohistochemistry and any lymphoma which is BCL2, overexpresses BCL2 or MYC would become a double expressor DLBCL. So I won't go into the details further than that, except to know that these are the worst prognostic subtypes, the double expressor DLBCL and the non-GCB DLBCL. How do we stage patients with lymphoma? We know that the Ann Arbor staging and how it goes, the stage 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm not going to go into those details. Suffice it to say that there are very clear recommendations on how we use imaging, or right now it would be PET scans, to very specifically stage these lymphomas. And whether it's in the node, the liver, spleen, CNS, wherever it is, this is the paper that actually guides us on specific staging of any lymphoma, be it PET avid or not avid, because this actually, you can see here that it mentions the test by which you're staging and what would be taken as involvement, yes or no. For instance, the spleen, on PET CT, a diffuse uptake, a solitary mass, miliary lesions or nodules would make it involvement by lymphoma. On a CT, more than 13 centimeter in vertical length, mass or nodules would make it involvement by lymphoma. So the just a mildly enlarged spleen in the absence of those masses, nodules, miliary would not make it a lymphoma, except if you had a diffuse uptake on PET scan. So the PET scan is the recommended imaging for staging of lymphomas as well as assessment through treatment and after treatment. Not all patients can afford a PET scan, so it's important to know that we can do a basic staging via CT, and when patients cannot even afford a CT, you could do it via an ultrasound and a chest X-ray. It does not impact treatment as much as one might think. Ideally, it's a PET scan. So is a bone marrow required if you have a PET scan? The PET scan is more sensitive than marrow because marrow can be, there can be focal involvement. So in two diseases, in Hodgkin's and DLBCL, a PET scan is adequate. You don't need to do a bone marrow if you have a PET scan showing the presence or absence of disease. So what is the role of PET scan in the management of lymphoma? It's important at the time of diagnosis for staging. This is not in all lymphomas, and it's mostly in PET avid lymphomas, and these are the any of the high-grade lymphomas and Hodgkin lymphoma as well. But important to know that there are many lymphomas that have a very, very low FDG avidity, and the absence of uptake does not mean that there's no involvement. At the time of diagnosis, a PET scan can also guide you in a site to biopsy, because sometimes in the absence of peripheral nodes, to know where to biopsy. At an interim PET, a PET is done anywhere between 2 to 4 cycles after chemotherapy. And it's only in Hodgkin lymphoma that a PET is used to guide therapy. I'll come to that a little bit later. But in other lymphomas, it's only an indicator of interim response, even in DLBCL. And there are no recommendations to change of therapy based on an interim scan. At the end of therapy, it's considered a standard of care for remission assessment. Once again, sometimes you can have PET positivity that is not equal disease. If you have a PET positive lesion, it's important to biopsy that, because not all PET positive lesions are significant for involvement with disease after therapy. So this is, I mentioned that in Hodgkin lymphoma, you can use an interim PET to guide therapy. This is just one. There are some ongoing trials which are looking at how DLBCL you can modulate therapy based on an interim PET. But this is just to show that basically if you have an interim PET that's negative after between 2 to 3 cycles, the outcome is better than if you have an interim PET positive. It's not indicating any change of therapy, but just that it's a prognostic marker. So how do you prognosticate patients with DLBCL? These are studies that have been done long ago and are still very relevant to us, even with there haven't been that many changes in therapy over the last 20 years. And so these are still the prognostic indices which are used. The IPI was the International Prognostic Index was first described in 1993. And they looked at a large number of DLBCLs that were treated with CHOP therapy. That was before the introduction of rituximab. And they found that the significant factors which impacted outcome were age, stage, performance status, elevated LDH, and the presence of more than one extranodal site. And based on that, they had 4 groups based on which one could predict what the outcome would be. This would not change therapy. It's just a prognostic indicator. The revised IPI was, or the RIPI with rituximab was, shows that they had essentially, with the same number of risk factors, you could still prognosticate patients, but really into 3 groups, either a low risk, intermediate risk, or high risk group, based on the number of risk factors they have. We use an age-adjusted IPI. If you hear that word, it's for patients who are entirely of one age group, all of them below 60 or all of them above 60, and then you remove the age from the prognostication, and there are fewer indicators of prognosis. So this is really a study tool. It's not used for clinical prognostication. It's just to show that the number of you know, the I can't read this, but it just shows the number of outcome measures they looked at, the what would modulate outcome, and of those, the ones I mentioned, the five that we mentioned, age, performance status, LDH, extranodal sites, and ECOG, would impact outcome. So how does that really change therapy, knowing what the prognostication is? It does change therapy, because when you initiate therapy with a patient who has the LBCL, it's important for that they have a realistic expectation of where the patient is going to be 2 years from now, because of the amount of family effort, money, time, and toxicity that goes into this therapy. So looking at the therapy in DLBCL, the basic chemotherapy, like I mentioned, is current standard is R-CHOP. There are certain patients who require CNS prophylaxis. There are some patients who need radiotherapy. And we need to give elderly DLBCL, we would need to attenuate the therapy for reasons of toxicity. Truncated therapy is something which is coming up in very early stage DLBCL, where if you have stage one disease and you have a PET negative, you can stop therapy after four cycles. What is the role of maintenance therapy in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma? Very briefly. So I mentioned that that CHOP therapy was the standard. This is cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, vincristine, and prednisolone. And it's not very toxic. This is given as an outpatient, and it's given once in every 3 weeks. You monitor for febrile neutropenia, and most patients would tolerate it extremely well. Each of these drugs have their own side effects. Cyclophosphamide, it's predominantly neutropenia. The doxorubicin, it could be cardiotoxicity. Vincristine is neurotoxic, and prednisolone has all the side effects of steroids. So, but people have looked at whether these are the outcomes in patients who have been treated either with CHOP or more intensified regimens, and you can see that really there's no benefit of intensification. So to date, it stays CHOP. There are a few other alternatives which one could use, specifically bendamustine, but by and large, CHOP is the therapy that's used in DLBCL. To add on to the CHOP, the addition of rituximab, and now it's been 20 years since rituximab has been added, but initially done in elderly patients, and then the same data showed that there was a benefit when you add rituximab to CHOP, even in young patients. And here you can see, actually, if you see the relapse-free survival, progression-free survival, there's about between a 10 to 20% benefit of the addition of rituximab. So if you don't have rituximab, you just have CHOP, it's around 60%. And this is looking at all patients. If you do have it, if you have rituximab, it's around 80%. And that's important because the CHOP in itself, the cost of therapy is about 4,000 rupees for one cycle. The entire cost of six cycles comes to around 30,000. But each dose of rituximab costs 35 to 40,000. So that can significantly add to the cost, especially if you have a patient who can't afford that therapy. You can still go ahead and give CHOP, understanding that the outcome is slightly inferior. So none of these drugs penetrate the CNS. There's a group of patients who have at a higher risk of relapse in the CNS, and they have an extremely poor prognosis. So we risk stratify patients at diagnosis itself by something called the CNS IPI, or the CNS International Prognostic Index. The presence of certain extranodal features, the involvement of the kidney or adrenal gland, age, elderly age, high LDH, poor performance status, more than one extranodal site. Many of these are included in the IPI, but specifically kidney, adrenal, and this doesn't include, but also breast, testis, all of these are at, if you have a patient who has DLBCL, they're at a higher risk of having CNS relapse. So these patients it's recommended to either give them an intrathecal therapy through chemo or give them IV methotrexate at a higher dose, so that will penetrate the CNS. This is the algorithm for patients who have a systemic DLBCL. You have to prognosticate them for CNS risk status. And those who are low risk probably don't need any further treatment other than R-CHOP. Patients who have a CNS IPI at a high score of 4 to 6 would need to have either IV methotrexate or high-dose methotrexate, as mentioned here. Unfortunately, once CNS relapse occurs, the prognosis is very poor. It's much poorer than even a patient who has a primary CNS lymphoma. there are certain patients who require radiotherapy as consolidation to therapy in DLBCL, and not going into the details here, but it's enough to know that there's a definition of bulk disease, which is different in different lymphomas. And for DLBCL, most people would consider 7.5 centimeters to be bulky. Anything more than that, you need to get consolidation RT at the completion of the R-CHOP therapy. So you can also, there's a role for giving radiotherapy to any PET positive sites, a little bit of residual PET positivity. Obviously, it should not be progressive disease, but a residual disease, a little bit, you can give IFRT at the end of chemo. There is now some data coming out that really in patients who are completely PET negative, there may not be a benefit of RT, but still now the guidelines state that anyone who has bulk disease, you have to give radiation at the end. And you can see here, this is the large trials in DLBCL, one of the large trials, which shows that patients who had bulk disease defined by 7.5 in the study, who received RT, the outcome was far superior. This is mostly for local relapse compared to those who did not receive RT. So there are some controversies in management in DLBCL. This is in that the poor prognostic subgroups who I mentioned, like the double expressor, double hit lymphomas, should one intensify therapy? Is there any benefit of intensification or not? Because you can add any number of drugs, change the regimens, you can do a transplant, but does that benefit or not? I'm leaving it at that because there are studies to both show that there's a benefit and there's no benefit. So as of now, the standard is to continue with R-CHOP. The maintenance therapy is something which, even when a patient is in remission, does the continuation of rituximab or any other drug after that improve their disease-free survival? And here again, in DLBCL, it's not standard. It's not one of the diseases where this is used is in low-grade lymphomas like follicular lymphoma, but in DLBCLs, this is not considered standard. So this is just to show that with regards to intensification, there have been numerous trials actually adding on different agents with all kinds of intensification, and to date, nothing has superior to R-CHOP. I may probably deal with follow-up right at the end because it goes for all lymphomas. Coming on to low-grade lymphomas, now the low-grade lymphomas again are a huge spectrum. I'll be talking about the low-grade B NHLs, but equally there are an equal number of low-grade T NHLs such as mycosis fungoids, other skin like TLGLs, large granulocytic leukemia lymphomas, where these diseases go on for years and often don't require treatment. But this next section is specific to the B NHLs, but the principles remain the same, whether it's T or B. So the initial phase of these diseases is extremely indolent. It can be picked up incidentally. It can be picked up on just a medical checkup or, and when patient is being tested for something else. And the initial phase can go on for years without requiring therapy. So that's the main reason why not everybody who's diagnosed with a low-grade NHL needs treatment. The second reason for not treating is that in most cases, these are not curable. In that, once you need to initiate therapy and you do so, there will be a relapse anywhere between three years, 5 years, for some patients, 8 years later, 10 years later. And so therefore, if there's no cure, it's just a matter of the overall survival doesn't change at all, whether you treat early or not. So therefore, most patients who have a low-grade NHL, in fact, all patients, there are specific indications which are required before one would initiate therapy. So that question to ask in the beginning, is this a low-grade or a high-grade disease, is of paramount importance. So I'll actually talk about CLL and very briefly follicular lymphoma, just to illustrate these principles of therapy. The treatment per se is almost exactly the same as for a DLBCL. It's with either with R-CHOP, or you can remove the anthracycline and just give R-CVP. You can give bendamustine instead of CHOP because it has less toxicity in elderly patients. But the treatment remains the same between the BNHLs. It's just that the time when you initiate treatment and the prognosis differs. So CLL is a low-grade neoplasm, and it's defined very specifically with an immunophenotype. which can be picked up either on flow cytometry or on the immunohistochemistry if one has a biopsy, where it's a CD20 positive neoplasm, CD23, and surface CD5 positive. These are mature B cell neoplasms, and you have to have at least 5 into 10 to the power of 9 or 5,000 per microliter of these cells on flow cytometry to call it a CLL. Anything less than that, one would call it a monoclonal B lymphocytosis. So these lymphoid cells need to be less than 55% to call them falling within the CLL. If they are more than that number, it goes on to a pro-lymphocytic leukemia. So CLL is the same as SLL, exactly the same. Whereas CLL presents in the blood, SLL will present in the nodes. It will be only nodal, and you'll have the same, you'll have this sort of immunohistochemical profile on the biopsy. And the number of B cells which are present in the peripheral blood will not be diagnostic for CLL itself by number. There is a low grade, like in myeloma, there's an MGUS which you can have for years before a patient develops myeloma. In CLL, there's a disease known as a monoclonal B lymphocytosis, where the immunophenotype is exactly the same, but just the number falls below the predefined cutoff for calling it CLL. There's also no lymphadenopathy, there's no cytopenia, and the patient is completely asymptomatic for usually several years, incidentally detected. So when we talk about prognosis, CLL is one of the diseases where the genetic alterations that are present will impact prognosis. And there are two different types of CLL, in the sense that one will arise from B cells that have a mutated immunoglobulin heavy chain, and one which arises from those which have an unmutated. And the unmutated have a much poorer prognosis than the mutated B cells. There are also other cytogenetic markers which will. This I'm not going into the details of this, but just to know that there are cytogenetic alterations which are present, which can help you to prognosticate when you diagnose the patient what is the chance of their rapid progression and eventual mortality because of these mutations. It's predominantly because some of these mutations are not susceptible or not sensitive to the routine chemotherapy use, and many of them require intensification of therapy. So none of these genetic alterations in itself is an indication for therapy. So sometimes we would not even do these at the time of diagnosis, because it doesn't change anything. When you decide to initiate therapy, you can do these tests at that time to prognosticate, but it does not change when you start therapy. So the CNS IPI, similar to the what was used in DLBCL. Now, almost every disease in lymphomas has its own international prognostic index. And some of these are a little difficult to, the DLBCL IPI is much easier because all of these are available to us, but some of these are not available to us at the time of diagnosis. For instance, we don't always do the genetic markers like the cytogenetics, like the 17p deletion and the immunoglobulin heavy chain mutation. These are not easily done. So, but just to know that the IPI does change outcome. It can predict time to first treatment, but a high IPI by itself is not an indication for initiation of therapy. So a patient comes in with a B lymphocytosis diagnosed to have CLL. When do we decide to treat? These are only if the patient develops cytopenias, in the sense you have advanced disease, either as stage 3, 4, or Bennett C, and you have bulk disease in the form of a large splenomegaly, significantly enlarged lymph nodes which are causing compression. They need not be very large to cause compression in the abdomen. So sometimes you can have patients who are going into a form of renal failure because of gradually progressive lymph nodes. If you have cytopenias, any B symptoms like fever, weight loss, recurrent infections. Progression to a DLBCL is definitely an indication for therapy. That's a rapid enlargement in any one lymph node. And here we follow the patient's lymphocyte count every 6 months. So if there's a slow increase, it's not an indication for therapy. Even if the patient has a count of 1 lakh, 1.5 lakhs, it's not an indication for therapy. But if a patient goes from 30,000 to 60,000 in 2 months, that has a lymphocyte doubling time of less than 6 months, and that is an indication for treatment. Moving on to follicular lymphoma, which is very similar in its in conceptually, gradual in onset, slow increase in size of nodes, and these are often picked up incidentally because the scan is done for another reason. And most patients, since they are nodal, will present only in late stages of disease. Very, very few patients will have early stage disease, and that's usually picked up incidentally. So follicular lymphoma has its own IPI, and you can see here that the IPI will tell us what the overall survival is going to be at 5 years and 10 years. It again does not impact whether or not we start therapy, but it gives you an idea of prognostication and how to speak to the patient. So approach to therapy in follicular lymphoma. Most patients will present in advanced stage. Very few patients will actually come in with stage one or two disease. And this could be, especially if they haven't come in with neck nodes, it's something which may be visible to them. And this can actually, there's a concept that either excision of that or local RT is curative, and it does not progress after that. But that need not be done for all. I mean, the option is either to do that or a close follow-up only. They may never progress. But just to know that the bulk of patients would actually present in advanced stage. So they would have stage 3 disease on both sides of the diaphragm or stage 4 disease. But since this is not curable, there have to be specific indications for treatment. And these are the criteria in follicular lymphoma. Again, more or less the same. It's only if there's bulky disease, if they have cytopenias or B symptoms or any form of, you know, it being more than an incidentally detected disease, then one would consider starting therapy. And again, here the treatment is exactly the same as what it is in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma with R-CHOP, except that there is a role for maintenance therapy, and that does increase the overall survival if you give maintenance rituximab for 2 years after completion of R-CHOP therapy. This is a recent publication that actually it's an abstract that came out last year on a large database, which actually shows us that even today with changes in therapy, different new monoclonal antibodies, there's actually no difference in the outcomes for patients who are either treated at the time of diagnosis or when you wait and watch. So except in one subtype of follicular lymphoma, and follicular lymphoma is low grade, but it can slowly go on to, it's grade 1, 2, and 3. And grade 3 can kind of border on the DLBCL spectrum. So that group, actually, there's a difference whether you have treated initially at the time of diagnosis or at the time the patient is symptomatic. Moving on to T-NHLs. T-NHLs are a very, very wide spectrum. They're actually very different from B-NHLs in that many of these are extranodal, and the extranodal lymphomas, T-NHLs are, they can present in the skin like mycosis, fungoids. They can present heterosplenic gamma delta lymphomas. They can present as NKT cell lymphomas. So they can present in the gut as enteropathy-associated T-cell lymphomas, subcutaneous panniculitis-like T-cell lymphomas. So just to say that they're as often nodal as they are extranodal. And the treatment for each of these varies very slightly. I'll just deal with the nodal T-cell NHLs very briefly. They are much rarer than B-cell NHLs. And if you look at all NHLs together, they would probably account for about between 10 to 15% of non-Hodgkin lymphomas. So they are rarer, and their prognosis is in general worse than B-cell lymphomas. So when you look at, if we look at the this list here, there is a group of these lymphomas that is nodal, and these include the peripheral T-cell lymphomas and ALK-positive, ALK-negative anaplastic large cell lymphomas. So these are the nodal T-cell lymphomas. In general, the outcome is much, much poorer, except for the one that is the bright green line on top, and that is the ALK-positive ALCL, anaplastic large cell lymphoma. All other T-cell lymphomas have a very poor prognosis. There's some data that if you intensify therapy with addition of etoposide, this can improve, but it's questionable because this data subset actually included ALK-positive patients also. So we don't know what the impact would be if it was just the poor prognostic subtype. In general, we would give the benefit of adding etoposide. So if you're ALK positive ALCL or the bright green line, we would go with just CHOP. And if you're any of the other nodal T-cell lymphomas, we would add on etoposide in addition for whatever benefit it might provide, especially if the patient is young. So there is another consolidation therapy which is used and which is considered standard of care in T-cell lymphomas, and that is because the prognosis is so poor, and that is an autologous stem cell transplant. There are very few indications for doing a transplant when the patient is in first remission, and for the current guidelines actually state that if possible, these patients should be consolidated with the transplant. So the benefit actually primarily comes with the ALK negative ALCLs, where you have a survival of around 60%, but in the others, there's a marginal benefit. Outcomes go from around 30% at 5 years to around 40-50%. It's not dramatic, but it's one of the things one could attempt to do in these very poor prognostic lymphomas. Part of it is that there's the equivalent of rituximab, which is there in the B-cell lymphomas. There's no monoclonal antibody, which is effective in these lymphomas. Moving on to Hodgkin lymphoma, it's a very, very different disease than the non-Hodgkin lymphomas. And this is one disease where advances in therapy have been the most and the most dramatic. We know that you can have these enlarged lymph nodes, which are classically described as being rubbery and non-tender. But one of the typical features of Hodgkin lymphoma when it presents in the mediastinum is you have a very, very large mediastinal mass that does not have any local effects. So the patient looks relatively well-preserved compared to the size of the mass in the mediastinum, as opposed to a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma or a primary mediastinal large B-cell lymphoma with the same similar sort of disease. Even a lymphoblastic lymphoma, you would have SVC syndrome, patient tachypneic, but in Hodgkin's, you could have a large mass and almost no symptoms. So this is showing the outcomes of Hodgkin lymphoma, just to know when we compare with where we are today. This was prior, about 50 years ago, the outcomes were absolutely dismal. And how the chemotherapeutic regimens have changed over the last several decades to change from being this to being around 80-90% survival. And now we are getting into the era of de-escalation of therapy so that we minimize toxicity. So these are current outcomes in Hodgkin lymphoma with the use of both BCOP as well as ABVD that we use. And the outcomes are extremely good. So how do you prognosticate? Not everyone has a good outcome in Hodgkin's. Hodgkin's has its own IPI. It's known as the Hasenclever Index or the International Prognostic Score. And for each of these score being positive, the outcome drops by between 5 to 7%. So a person who has no risk factors at all, the outcome would be 90%. And for the others, it would drop down to 50% slowly. So all patients do need to have a risk stratification and diagnosis. We must not assume that it being a highly curable lymphoma, that's generalizable to all. The PET scan has a particularly important role in the treatment of Hodgkin lymphoma, and that is because Hodgkin is a highly PET-avid disease. It helps. You can decide on which site to biopsy, like in DLBCL, but much more importantly, doing a PET scan at the end of two cycles, it's known as the interim PET-2 or the iPET-2. It helps you to decide how well this patient is doing and whether to de-escalate therapy because they're doing so well or whether to intensify therapy because the PET still remains positive. And I'll come into a little bit of this data and why that's important for us. PET also has a huge role in Hodgkin lymphoma at the end of therapy. Because of its sensitivity, and if PET negative, then the risk of relapse is extremely low. So the staging, as I mentioned, the JCO paper had shown earlier, that holds good for both Hodgkin as well as non-Hodgkin lymphomas. So it defines whether by CT and by PET, what are the criteria by which you would stage disease. Now, patients in Hodgkin lymphoma, as opposed to DLBCL, all patients with DLBCL are treated with R-CHOP 6 cycles, except the very, very early stage. But here, there's a stratification of disease in Hodgkin's into early stage, early stage favorable, early stage unfavorable, advanced stage and bulk stage disease. And each of these would have their own protocols, which I won't go into the details of, but the ABVD regimen is the backbone of therapy. And there are some modifications which are done based on which of these prognostic groups you fall into. So between 4 to 6 cycles of ABVD therapy is standard, and it may include radiation therapy in some patients, either with bulk disease or if you're attenuating the chemotherapy. If you don't give 6 cycles, you could just give 4 cycles and RT or 2 cycles and RT based on what the stage is. So the there is the interim assessment and then the post-treatment PET. It takes around 6 months for the entire therapy. And to just note that the positive predictive value of the PET at the end of this is only about 65%. So any PET positive disease has to be biopsied before one considers that the patient has not responded. The main problem with treatment of Hodgkin's disease is actually the bleomycin and the palmate toxicity associated with that. Bleomycin. You could go through 6 cycles of ABVD without any symptoms at all. It's tolerated very well. It's given every 2 weeks, hardly any cytopenia. It's completely OPD based. But the moment a patient starts developing bleomycin toxicity, it can, unless it's picked up early, it's quite rapidly progressive and it can be fatal. So they found that if you try and omit that bleomycin at the beginning itself, if you just give AVD and no bleo, the outcomes are inferior to the giving bleomycin at all. So there are some ways that we now circumvent the 6 cycles of bleomycin if possible. And that is by 2 ways. It's either through a PET or it's by the addition of brentuximab. So this here, this picture is just showing illustratively of the outcomes in a patient who has an interim PET positive versus an interim PET negative. And you know, stage 1 and 2 disease and stage 3 and 4 disease is only in Hodgkin's, showing that the PET actually is highly, the interim PET is highly sensitive to overall outcome in Hodgkin's. So normally when we assess a patient by PET, a person who has a score of 5 is considered to have progressive disease, and that's when everything is compared, the uptake with the liver. So if you have a PET dual score of 5, that's considered progression. If you have a score of 4, it's partial response but still significant disease. A score of 3 can be considered to have, depending on the clinical scenario, the patient could be considered to be in remission. But it's not quite the same as having a score of 1 or 2. And both of those indicate a very good remission. Score of 3, the chance of relapse is higher than if you have a score of 1 or 2. A score of 3 does not necessarily mean that you need to intensify treatment. It's just to be interpreted with caution. So there are many, many PET-guided regimens, either in both in early stage disease as well in advanced stage. And for example, I'm showing this one because in advanced stage disease, this is where most patients would get 6 cycles of ABVD. And we do see that elderly patients, patients with any sort of comorbidity or pre-existing lung disease, are much more prone to having bleomycin toxicity. So what they've done in this trial is really they've looked at patients in advanced Hodgkin's, done an interim PET after 2 cycles. So an IPET2. And those patients who are PET negative, they've randomized them to omitting bleomycin in a subset of the patients. So they actually found that there was no, they're exactly the same outcomes with the omission of bleomycin if your interim PET is negative. So that's one huge benefit of doing an IPET2 in patients with advanced stage disease if they can afford. PET positive patients were actually had, they have a poor outcome. So in this study, they had actually escalated the therapy, but actually there's not much benefit of escalation as well. It's just a marker of the poor disease biology in itself. So again, here you can see that there are 3 times when a PET is recommended. It's recommended at staging, it's recommended interim, and it's recommended at the post-treatment PET. A PET scan, as we know, costs around 30,000 rupees here. ABVD itself, each cycle is, each dose is around 4,000. So the entire 12 cycles, which are done at 2 weekly intervals or for 6 months, comes to around 60,000. And the PET itself is, you know, sometimes there are very, very frequently we find patients who can't afford a pet or they can afford only one PET scan. So the question is, when do you do the PET? It's not necessary to do it at diagnosis, then it's probably better to do it at either at interim or post-therapy. So there are many risk factors which define unfavorable disease. And I'm not going into this, but according to different treatment groups, they use different things. What we use is a large medicinal mass that's defined as more than 10 centimeters. Patient who has B symptoms, elevated ESR, or age more than 50. And depending on which part of the world you're in, these unfavorable diseases are defined in different ways. So I'm just here in the next couple of slides, I'm just showing the treatment protocols. This is just one treatment protocol, just an example, and each of these groups would have a different treatment protocol based on that risk stratification. So this is this treatment of limited stage disease as per the European guidelines, and this is their treatment algorithm, how they would go based on whether the interim PET is positive or negative. This is how they would treat a patient with advanced stage Hodgkin's, and this is just an example of one treatment protocol. But it's different from DLBCL in that there are decisions that one makes at different points in time based on response by PET. So what we do here is we would stage a patient using a PET or a CT, and that would give us the initial stage of disease. If you have stage 1A or stage 2A disease, that's in the absence of any of the unfavorable features as well as no B symptoms, we would go for 4 cycles of therapy. If you get an interim PET done and that's negative, then we can give 4 cycles of ABVD and stop. You could also consider giving just the 2 cycles plus RT for patients who do not want chemo. If a PET is positive, then we would continue with the 4 cycles and give RT, or we would give 6 cycles of ABVD. There's a huge number of patients who can't afford those PETs. PET scans. So then in those patients, what we do is we assume them to be advanced stage and we just give them 6 cycles of ABVD and we reassess with an ultrasound and a chest X-ray at the end of therapy. So this is again an algorithm for advanced stage Hodgkin's, the algorithm that we use. It's again using interim PET, you can de-escalate therapy. In a young patient who's tolerating well, one might not want to de-escalate, but really, looking at the data, there's no harm in removing the bleomycin. Plus, at the end, you give involved field RT to any area which had bulky disease. Patient who cannot afford a PET, financial constraints for even a CT, just an ultrasound chest X-ray, and the entire chemotherapy is done around 50,000 rupees over 6 months. And then we again end therapy, we would do an ultrasound and chest X-ray. The RT would remain even in patients who have financial constraints, because it's been shown that if you give IFRT, it does reduce the risk of local relapse. So this is, we've actually shown that between these two groups, if you look at the group who have had just an ultrasound and a chest X-ray versus those who have had a PET or a CT, not considering at that time you were not de-escalating at all. So if you do not de-escalate therapy, then essentially the therapy is the same. Both get 6 cycles of ABVD and there's no difference in outcome. If you're early stage, you have an extremely good outcome, whichever your imaging modality is. If you have advanced stage disease, you have a poorer outcome, no matter what imaging you use. Of course, this is not using the de-escalation strategy that we use now. Just to show that you can modify therapy and make it affordable for everybody, in a sense, with still good outcomes. So there have been a lot of advances in therapy in Hodgkin's lymphoma, much more than in non-Hodgkin, and these are related to monoclonal antibodies. The brentuximab is the anti-CD30 antibody, which is targeted therapy. It is targeted, but it has significant toxicities that come along with it, hepatotoxicity, cardiac arrhythmias, and it's not. And the most important thing about why this is not used upfront, like how we use R-CHOP for all our patients, is that its cost. The cost initially of the original molecule is around 8 lakhs for one cycle. So that really limits which patients we can use this in. The PD-1 inhibitors, nivolumab and pembrolizumab, as well as the immunomodulators like lenalidomide, these are much more affordable and they have had a significant impact in our treatment protocols. So this is just to show the mechanism of action of brentuximab. But brentuximab actually has made a significant gains in the West on upfront therapy in patients who have HIV, who have advanced stage disease, both of which are prognostically much poorer subgroups. It was initially used in patients who have relapsed post allogeneic transplant and patients who are refractory. And you can see here, these are patients who actually have gone into remission with brentuximab after relapse after allogeneic transplant, and they have a sustained remission. So it's a very potent drug. It's just that its efficacy is offset by its financial toxicity for us. This shows the patients in advanced stage Hodgkin's with the addition of brentuximab compared to without. More relevant to us because it's more affordable are the checkpoint inhibitors, nivolumab and pembrolizumab. These cost around 1.5 lakhs for a month of therapy. It's still extremely expensive. We incorporate it into our treatment algorithms when patients either are refractory or they have a relapse and are relapse after transplant. And these act by blocking the programmed cell death, ligands actually render the T cells ineffective. There's a decreased effector function, decreased antigen recognition. And by blocking, this is the tumor cell which is overexpressing the PD-1, PD-L1 antigens on the surface. So by breaking the link between the two, it enhances the host's own immunity, and that is it is a sort of immunotherapy in that sense, where it allows the host's own T cells to attack the tumor cells. It's extremely effective, and now current regimens there are a lot of studies looking at the use of nivolumab, pembrolizumab in upfront therapy. As for date, we have not incorporated these, primarily for cost reasons. So relapse in Hodgkin's lymphoma as well as non-Hodgkin's, actually, I would say that, let me say this, relapse in lymphomas occur in about 20-30% of patients. All patients can be offered salvage therapy, and outcomes after stem cell transplant are in the range between 40-60%. So even after relapse, outcomes are fairly good. If you relapse late, the outcomes are significantly late, can be defined either as 1 year or 2 years after completion of therapy. Your outcomes are significantly better than if you have an early relapse. A patient who has a relapse after autologous transplant or an extremely young patient who has refractory disease can be considered for an allogeneic transplant, either with a max sibling donor or even a haploidentical transplant, which are very effective in Hodgkin lymphoma specifically. One of the things about the follow-up that one of the earlier slides actually mentioned, we follow up these patients once a scan is done and a post-therapy scan is done. This scan is never repeated after that unless the patient is symptomatic. And that's because it causes a lot of anxiety sometimes and doesn't often change therapy. So it's a clinical follow-up once in 3 months for a year and then 6 months to once a year after that. At the end of 5 years, a patient is considered not in low-grade lymphomas, but in high-grade lymphomas, they are considered to be cured. And unless they're symptomatic, we would not call them back after that. There are late effects of all these chemotherapy, the most important being myelodysplastic syndromes, which arise from the anthracyclines which are used. But sometimes, these are not really... The risk of these events occurring is very, very low. So we monitor them, but not aggressively. And in essence, if the patient is otherwise clinically well, no scans are repeated and just blood counts are done once in every few months for up to 5 years. So the take home for Hodgkin lymphoma here would be that ABVD still remains a cornerstone of therapy and bleomycin toxicity is still a concern. That's what has led to risk-adapted therapies and which have allowed us to reduce toxicity either by omitting bleo or by adding nivolumab and brentuximab. These newer agents have significantly improved the outcomes in Hodgkin's. And in relapsed Hodgkin's disease, autologous transplant still holds hope for a lot of patients for cure. So in non-Hodgkin lymphoma, one would say that diffuse large B-cell lymphoma is the most common and is treated with overall, if one was to look at treatment with R-CHOP, the progression-free survival in the range of 70%, that is very much dependent on the IPI, as well as which subtype we talk about. The double expressor, double hit, as well as the non-GCP subtypes have a poorer prognosis. That is important to remember, because not everybody will have this 70% PFS. Low-grade lymphomas, there must be an indication before one offers therapy. And at each relapse, you use different chemo regimens which they have not been exposed to in the past. If it's a young patient who has a low-grade lymphoma, these are rare. They mostly occur in older patients. We know that. But they can occur in young. And if they do, one could consider an allogeneic transplant as a curative treatment for a young patient with a NHL, a low-grade NHL. And T-cell lymphomas are very, very outcome is very subtype dependent. They are either nodal or extranodal, and the outcomes are much poorer than B-cell lymphomas. So I think that's the, I tried to put these very varied diseases into 1 hour. I hope it was of some use. If you have any questions, please, you can contact me at any time. You wish. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. I think that was, as you said, mentioned, that's a very vast topic, but I think very much simplified and put up across to us. And I think the take-home message is quite made it clear how you have taken through all the different types of lymphomas, ma'am. As you mentioned about the ABVD and the ABD possible, and then adding on nivolumab, all those are kind of, I think, prognostication part. And also the non-Hodgkin lymphoma being treated as a high risk and a low risk thing. There was one question, ma'am, in the chat box. HIV associated DLBCL, are there any special considerations?
HIV associated DLBCL actually is, the outcome is not, what would one say? With optimal therapy, they go into long-term remission, so it's not bleak. You can either treat with just R-CHOP in itself, but there are a few caveats to that. We would want to intensify by giving IT methotrexate or high-dose methotrexate. They are at a higher risk of having a CNS relapse, HIV-associated DLBCL. And aside from that, because the disease is slightly more aggressive, you could consider giving a slight intensification of that R-CHOP in that. There's a protocol called dose-adjusted EPOC, which is essentially the same drugs, but it's given as an infusion that increases its efficacy and toxicity as well. But HIV-associated DLBCL, otherwise, it's actually more than the HIV association. It's really the subtype. What subtype is it within DLBCL? That's important.
Thank you, ma'am. I think as a physician, I think we meet patients at the level of maybe a pre-diagnostic in terms of having a post-diagnostic relapse, post-treatment relapse, or maybe in terms of oncological emergencies, which we might.
Right. So, ma'am, do you want to say anything? Yeah, actually, I did not go into the tumor lysis part because if I can just show this one. I think the considerations one need to have when you see a patient who's, not. In general medicine, the first would be that the type of biopsy that you do, ideally, it really should be an excision biopsy. FNAC is not enough for the diagnosis of lymphoma. If it's absolutely impossible to get an excision biopsy, then a TrueCut biopsy would do. But that's one thing, the adequacy of the material. And when a pathologist says suspicious of lymphoma, that's not enough to say lymphoma. There are now, we can do clonality on the histopathology also, but suspicious is not enough. Suggestive is actually good enough to treat a patient. So they say, atypical cells suggestive of DLBCL, that's enough for treatment, yeah. Ideally, there should be an excision so that the pathologist can see the morphology and give a very clear picture. Because as you can see, the DLBCL is like it's just now a broad umbrella term for so many diseases. And what I wanted to show in this is that really DLBCL in itself, the treatment of standard DLBCL is outpatient based. It's not at a high risk for tumor lysis. We don't give tumor lysis prophylaxis. We just tell patients to drink enough water. But on the other hand, if you have a ABC or a non-GCB subtype, you can see markers of proliferation like a high LDH, advanced stage disease. Then, and as you move to the left of this, you see these intermediate double hit lymphomas, Burkitt lymphomas. These are the ones which have either spontaneous or treatment-induced tumor lysis. And then you have to aggressively, give prophylaxis or, therapy for tumor lysis. And I'm sure that would have been covered in the acute leukemias. Yes. No? Huh?
Maybe you want to repeat one.
Sure, yeah. The cornerstone of actually treatment for tumor lysis is prevention. If you prevent tumor lysis, that is 90% of the battle. It hinges around adequate hydration and giving either allopurinol or febuxostat. And if a patient has got a high uric acid, then neither of these drugs would work, so you would give raspuricase. It's again, in DLBCL, this is not something which we frequently see, but in something like Burkitt or a double hit lymphoma, you could see it where you have the markers of, first you start off with a biochemical tumor lysis. So we would actually monitor these somewhere between 6 hours to 12 hours, every 6 to 12 hours. And if, based on the trend, you could decrease the monitoring for these patients. But there's no question that hydration of at least 3 liters per meter square is really the cornerstone. And ensuring adequate diuresis. If that is not happening, then we probably would need to call in nephrology. But it's not cut down on hydration, even if output is not good. So that's, yeah.
Post-treatment, relapse point, as you mentioned, ma'am, unless they're symptomatic, we usually don't, once this is free for 5 years,
Yes. And sometimes, when we see something on a scan and some patients can be very anxious, that anxiety lasts for some patients, it lasts for a lifetime. And they come in with a little bit of problem and say, I need a scan. And then you do it, and then you realize there's nothing there. So really they've looked at patients who have had repeated scans versus patients who have had come in only when symptomatic. And actually even the regular checkups don't help in picking up the disease. It's just to keep them in touch with you. And then when they are symptomatic, that's when you pick up relapse. Yeah, especially because not in leukemias, leukemias, these it can be picked up in the peripheral blood, but none of the lymphomas you can, except for the CLL, of course. Yeah.
So that imaging part, as you mentioned, whether you do.
Just one end therapy, and then if there is a real doubt in that, you could repeat it once more to see the trend. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but no more than that. Yeah.
Any further questions? Ma'am, I did a total justice with the topic that has been given. I think please feel free to ask if any questions or mail to medical@cmcalone.ac.in. This lecture will be uploaded on the Department of Medicine YouTube website. Thanks again, ma'am, for taking the lecture for us. And thanks to you guys. We'll exit.
Okay. Thank you.